Now, in a good argument, as I mentioned before, there's two styles, and we're going to go into depth on these. There's two types of arguments. An argument can either support the conclusion strongly, which is like building up evidence for a case, like a murder trial or something. That's inductive reasoning, where the conclusion is rendered more likely based on the evidence provided, the reasons, the premises given. The other form of argumentation is known as deductive reasoning, and this is based on certainty, and this is an argument in which the conclusion is rendered certain. The conclusion becomes certain as a result of the truth of the premises that were given, or the reasons given. So, arguments are also often controversial. They often make controversial claims. We should go to war, we shouldn't go to war, is often a conclusion to a political argument. The refugees and the migrant caravan at the border that many have been talking about, we should help them, we shouldn't help them. Those are controversial claims either way. We should understand controversy broadly, right? A controversial claim might just be something that's challenging an understanding, you know, like, well, no, I thought you said that the movie starts at this time, but I checked here and it starts here, right? So it's something that challenges our current understanding of something. Now, not all arguments have a direct controversial claim, so I want to make that clear. It's just a way to help you recognize the conclusion in many arguments is to find that controversial claim. Now, I want to just give you some examples. Let's say you saw this passage. It says, Hillary Clinton is totally an insider. She's worked in Washington her whole life, and 90% of her campaign contributions come from Wall Street donors. And remember, an argument... No, actually, there's one other thing that I didn't mention about arguments that I need to mention. And that's that in an argument, there is a relevant connection between the premises and conclusion given. That's actually what distinguishes an argument, good reasoning, from a fallacy that we'll talk about later, bad reasoning. So an argument has to have relevance between the premise and conclusion. Just to briefly go back to what I was saying about the rain example, if I say it's raining because there's water falling from the sky, that's an argument. I provided evidence for why it's raining. But what if I said it's raining because there's water flowing in the gutter? Not really relevant to, I mean, there could be water in the gutter because someone's washing their car, right? That wouldn't be a good reason to believe that it's raining. So what I'm pointing out there has to be relevance between premise and conclusion. So now let's go back to the Hillary Clinton one. Is there relevance between the premise and conclusion? And also, what is the conclusion and what are the premises? Well, the first thing you want to look at, as I just said, can you find an controversial claim? Yeah, I think the first claim is fairly controversial, that she's an insider. What do they mean by that? They mean that she's an elite, that she doesn't, she's connected with all those with power and money. You know, she's not one of us. She's not a populist. She's not part of the regular population. She's this elite. That's what it means to be an insider, right? That's a fairly controversial thing to say about somebody. And then, okay, but what about the other claims? They're a little bit controversial. She's worked in Washington her whole life and her campaign contributions. But now ask yourself this question. Which claim is providing evidence for the other ones, right? Is her being an insider evidence that she's worked in Washington? It doesn't really make much sense, right? It's not, her being an insider is more of a general claim that seems to be supported by these examples, right? So in this case, the conclusion is actually stated first. Another lesson in critical thinking, although I set up many arguments in the reader in what's called premise conclusion format. So you can see premise 1, 2, 3, and then the conclusion, right? That's very clear. Although I do that, and many academics do, not all writers do that. So sometimes a writer will draw a conclusion first, and then they'll give their evidence for it. So it's not about the order of the way something's presented, it's about the logic, the connections between ideas. So again, we have here two pieces of evidence that she's worked in Washington her whole life, and a lot of her, and 90% of her contributions came from Wall Street. Those are two pieces of evidence used to support the conclusion that she is an insider. Okay, so now we've recognized that A, this is an argument, And B, we've identified the premises and conclusion and how they're working together. Right? So that's an example of how to think critically about these problems. Now, what if I wanted to state the issue in that argument? Let me say this, and I've said it before in the readings, and I'll say it again probably in future videos. The issue is merely the conclusion of an argument restated as a question. One more time. The issue in a passage is the conclusion of the argument restated as a question. So can you figure out what the issue in this previous argument was? Well, the conclusion is Clinton is an insider. So the issue would then be whether Hillary Clinton is an insider, whether or not Hillary Clinton is an insider. Or the issue would be, is Hillary Clinton an insider? Right? There's different ways to express the question, but it's important to understand there's a difference between expressing a question as to whether something's true and stating it's actually true. The statement that it's actually true, that she is an insider, that's the conclusion, because the person takes a stand on the issue. The issue, though, is just, is she an insider or not? Notice that somebody could take the opposite stand and say she's not an insider, and here's why. Okay, so I'm going to present you with a conclusion, and then I'll present you some options, and I want you to think about which one of these options would be most relevant to the conclusion to turn it into an argument. Okay. So here's your conclusion. Citizens should be allowed to carry guns. Option number one. And once again, that's your conclusion. I'm going to present three options. You're going to figure out which one is a relevant premise that, together with the conclusion I just gave you, would turn that into an argument. So if my conclusion is citizens should be allowed to carry guns, my first reason might be there are many different types of guns. Or is my premise the Second Amendment gives us the right to bear arms? Or is my premise the 14th Amendment implies the right to privacy? Okay, so which one of those would most relevantly fit with the conclusion? I'm guessing most of you would say B, right? Because we all know the Second Amendment is the amendment that gives us the right to bear arms, right? Now, people disagree on how to interpret it, obviously, but that is clearly relevant to the conclusion. Now, to be fair, the 14th Amendment one wouldn't necessarily be a bad answer, because one could, after all, in Roe v. Wade, the Supreme Court justices invoked the 14th Amendment and the woman's right to privacy with her own body as one of the justifications for why abortion should be legal. So one could similarly invoke the right to privacy in carrying a gun. So I would say, I'd still say two is the most relevant, but three would somewhat fit if you added some additional premises as well to the argument. But certainly number one would not be relevant. The fact that there are different types of guns is not a good reason for why we should be allowed to carry them. Let's do another God one. Let's say my conclusion is God exists. What if I said, and then my conclusion is God exists, so I'll give you three potential premises, and you'll tell me which one is a legitimate premise that would turn this into an argument. So if the first premise is, well, my parents and priest say that God exists, therefore God exists. The second is, you'll go to hell if you don't believe in God. And the third is, something had to cause the universe. So I hope you can all recognize that three is the legitimate premise. Now, let me tell you why one and two don't work. So premise one isn't what's called an appeal to authority fallacy. Right? The mere fact that a lot of people believe something, or people you respect believe something, that doesn't mean that it's true or it's right. It would be the same thing with evolution. If I said evolution's true only because this really smart biology professor believes it, that would equally be a bad, not an argument. Now, the second answer says, I hope you can all recognize the problem here. You'll go to hell if you don't believe in God, right? That's a scare tactic, a fallacy that uses emotion to get you to believe something instead of providing evidence or reasons. You know, it'd be like if I said, well, you're going to be grounded if you don't do your homework, right? It's not really a reason why I should do my homework. It's a reason to be afraid if I don't do my homework. But something had to cause the universe, right? That's a good reason to believe that there may be a God, because God is supposed to be an all-powerful being who can create at will, well, that's perfectly relevant to the start or beginning of the universe. Now, again, I want to be clear, you don't have to agree with an argument to know that it's an argument, but that is an argument. There is a relevant premise provided connecting to a relevant conclusion. And in fact, it's a famous argument for God, sometimes called the first cause argument or the cosmological argument.